This is an outsider's guide to the Rust project. So there's a lot of people here who have used Rust or have probably heard a lot about the Rust project, but you probably don't necessarily all have the vocabulary or know how the inner workings of Rust really works. So this is a short introduction to that of what the words and things you might see while you're learning about Rust. So I'm James Munns. I'm a member of the launching pad representative of the Leadership Council. I work at a company called One Variable, and I've been involved in the embedded working group since the beginning. And I'm also joined by Jack.
So I'm Jack. I'm a Leadership Council member representing the Lang team. My primary gig is actually as a grad student studying mouse thymus development. But I've been involved in the project since 2019, where I'm mainly focused on the type system.
So one of the most important questions is, who is responsible for Rust? We know that Rust happens, it has releases, it's a tool that we all use, but who's responsible for making Rust what Rust is? Now, there might be two groups that you might have heard of before. The Rust Project and the Rust Foundation. And I've got a blank slide, so you have to imagine two boxes next to each other, one that says Rust, there you go. So there's two organizations you might think of as responsible for Rust, the Rust Project and the Rust Foundation. So starting with the Rust Foundation, the younger of these two organizations, which was established in 2021, this is a non-stock, non-for-profit membership corporation. So the Rust Foundation has a couple of responsibilities, and the folks that work for it are largely broken up into three groups. They've got full-time staff that run wonderful events like RustConf. They've got a board of directors that make decisions for what the Rust Foundation should be doing. Some of those are the companies that make up the Rust Foundation as sponsors, and there's even representation from the Rust Project itself that get to be a part of that decision-making process. And the other group is the member companies that make up the Rust Foundation. These are all of those very well-known companies that you know that are vocal in their support and interest in Rust and are interested in seeing Rust continue to grow and want to support that. Now, if we look at the bylaws of the Rust Foundation, the thing that stands out immediately is the primary purpose of the foundation is to support and promote the Rust project. And the Rust project is the principal developer of the Rust programming language. So that already gives us two pretty important pieces of information. The Rust project is responsible for the Rust programming language, and the Rust Foundation is there to support the Rust project, whether it's running events like this, or financial support, or logistics and infrastructure, and everything that Dr. Ramble said this morning in the opening keynote. And now we get to the Rust project. So the Rust Project, unlike the Rust Foundation, is a largely volunteer organization that is developing Rust. It's the open source community that you know, the people that you've met at other conferences like this. Similarly, it's made up of three kind of major groups. There's the Leadership Council, which Jack and I are a part of, which is sort of the main governance organization within the project. There are the project teams that are responsible for a lot more things that I'm going to get into in a second. And there's a bunch of other organizations like working groups and things like that that are also handling different aspects of the whole Rust ecosystem and community. So the Rust project itself is made up of teams that we can kind of start to look at from the top down. And these teams are responsible for what most people think of as Rust. When you think of Rust, you're probably thinking of some concrete part. And those concrete parts might be the compiler itself, developer tools like cargo, the infrastructure and the CI that goes on behind the scenes, the standard library. All of these things are run by a team within the Rust project. Currently, this is a snapshot of what today's Rust teams look like. These have changed over time, and they probably will continue to change over time. But these seven teams are our top-level teams, or kind of the biggest groups within the Rust project itself. Now, these teams have an interesting responsibility. Because there are top-level teams, there are biggest group of people, they have the responsibility of also nominating someone to the Leadership Council. So when I mentioned that there are seven of these top-level teams, if we look at these 7 top-level teams, and we then look at the leadership console, which Jack and I are a part of, we see also 7 people, and there are 1 representative nominated by each of those top-level teams who are then represented in the leadership council. So we have representatives from all 7 of these teams up here. And I think we have 4 of us from the leadership council here today? 4 of us, I think. So 4 out of 7 are in the room today if you'd like to talk with any of these faces. Now, if the term leadership council doesn't ring a bell to you, but you have heard of the core team before, in 2022, the core team was replaced with the leadership council. I mentioned before that the leadership council is sort of the main governance organization of the Rust project today. This group is sort of a back and forth between the different teams. Each of these teams nominate 1 member that gets put on the leadership council. And in turn, the leadership council is this main governance structure that then says, hey, we need teams to focus on these things. We need to focus on this and have someone taking care of this. And in the RFC that was put together for the leadership council, it's phrased as these project members collectively confer the authority to ensure successful operation of the project. So generally, the leadership council is asked to say, hey, we need to figure out how we make sure that the project is successful, and these teams are the ones that actually execute that. Now, I've mentioned 7 groups, but there's actually a lot more to that. These project teams actually all end up being a little fractal. Teams have sub-teams and working groups and project groups and things like that. There's actually a lot of recursive structures going on underneath those 7 teams. For example, the Lang team, once this loads, has 6 sub-teams. They've got special sub-teams for things like Lang advisors or docs or operations or the OPSEM team, figuring out what unsafe does and doesn't mean. I'm really missing these graphics, but the real point is that these top-level teams have groups that are focused on different aspects of the project itself. And in total, we have hundreds of people as part of the Rust project, and all of these folks are kind of collected into these teams for making Rust happen. But when we have these hundreds and hundreds of people, how do these groups decide what Rust is today and what Rust should be in the future?
So there's a lot that goes into these questions, and I unfortunately don't have the time to go through them all. And so I'm not going to go focus on how individual teams decide what they do, but instead I want to focus on 3 high-level ideas. First, how does the project communicate with each other? Second, what are the processes that we use to make decisions? And then finally, for fun, talk about some of the bots that we use to keep things running smooth. So starting with how we communicate, there's a few things on this list, but the sort of key idea between all of them is the underlying question of how do we talk to each other and keep track of it all and make it accessible, not just for observation, but for participation. And I want to start with where most day-to-day discussions happen, which is on Zulip. And if you were to open the Zulip today and dig around a little bit, you might find the screen something like this, where on the left, you have 1 channel per team, group, or project. And then within a channel, you'll have multiple topics that are separated into separate conversations. And then for a given conversation, you'll have multiple messages that are all grouped together. And as you scroll back, you can see all the messages no matter the time. And so you don't have to scroll back and go through multiple different conversations. But the most important part of Zulip, it's not really showing up, is that you can log in, but you don't have to. Anyone can read most of the channels on Zulip without logging in. And so this is great for archiving and for observation. The other big part of the way we communicate is GitHub. And this is where most technical development happens and some record keeping. So, no picture, it might load in a second. You might know that the Rustling org has a GitHub page. and you might know that the compiler and standard library are hosted on GitHub. You might even know that the RFCs, which I'll talk about later, are on GitHub. But did you know that each team group may also have a repository associated with it? And these repositories may host minutes for meetings, policies, or even sometimes technical documents. And of course, there are others, right? I put 6 on this list and I didn't include them all. But there's an official Discord which teams used to use to host conversations, and a few still do. There's an internals discourse site that some conversations happens on. Some teams decide to do synchronous meetings that are video chat, and meet.jitsi is a popular option. And then some groups, namely the embedded working group, will use alternative communication platforms such as Matrix. But communication is great, but it doesn't tell us everything. Particularly, we need to know and have some kind of underlying processes to make decisions. As I alluded to before, probably the most important of these is called the RFC process. And the RFC process, at its core, provides a way to have a consistent and controlled path for changes to the Rust language and project to happen in a way that all stakeholders can be confident about the direction. And most RFCs are technical. So your favorite features like async await or even the crates.io sparse index, these are eventually, you know, stemming from RFCs. But some RFCs are used to shape the way the project runs. For example, new teams being formed, new government structures, the way we ship and think about distributing the Rust project, and even new additions. But in general, RFCs are used for big or impactful changes. But of course, each team has specific processes for smaller changes. If you've ever heard of things like MCPs or ACPs, these are examples of those. But we have these processes for identifying changes, but how do we know when something should be accepted? And this is where FCPs, or final comment periods, proposed final comment periods, comes in. And these are used to obtain consensus about a decision. Why consensus? Well, the majority vote is not always best. Sometimes, and oftentimes, the minority vote has some kind of idea that will make the final result be better. And so we want to make sure that we're capturing that voice and not leaving it in the dust. In our case, we define consensus as 2 things. First, there are no objections to the vote. And second, there's at most 2 missing yes votes. In between these 2, we ensure that we've heard at least enough of the voices to know that, you know, somebody's paying attention and that we haven't missed anything major. And importantly, after consensus is reached, there's still a 10-day waiting period called the final comment period, where we wait for feedback before we move on. And this allows anybody to come and make feedback. And you might be asking, that sounds like a lot to keep track of. And you would be right, which is where the final part of what I'm going to talk about today is, which is bots. And you can think of bots like our clerks. They keep things running smooth. For example, Bors is the backbone for Rust CI. Bors is responsible for ensuring that every change gets tested and builds, which also makes it the most highly ranked contributor to the Rust language. Crater is a tool we use to run experiments across parts of the Rust ecosystem. If you have a crate on GitHub or on crates.io, it's likely that we test it every release to ensure we don't break it. TriageBot, sometimes called RustBot, does, well, a lot. On GitHub, we use TriageBot to ensure that every pull request gets a reviewer. We use it to make sure that if a change is going to affect some part of the compiler or standard library and a certain group wants to know about that change, they get pinged. On Zulip, we use it to help our meetings run smoother. But overall, you might say bots are pretty cool. And overall, those three ideas will hopefully give you some idea of how the Rust project runs. It's not the most complete description, but it's good for the time. And you might be looking at all this and be thinking, great, how can I get involved? And the first thing you can do is use and test the language and the standard library and all the tools. Use nightly and beta to test the changes before they hit stable. If you find something that you don't like, whether it be a bug or just a really bad compiler error, file bugs, file issues. If you find an experience was really nice or really terrible, write blog posts. We love to see those. And if you have used the language and find you still want to be more of a participant, join the discussions. Come chat with us on Zulip about how things work. Go to GitHub and write a comment on an RFC that you really like and think you can make better. Go on social media and talk to other people about what goes well and what doesn't. And if this is still not enough, then contribute. And unfortunately, you might be saying, wait, but how? And I could make a whole talk out of this, and I definitely don't have time. But I did want to point out a couple things that we're doing as a project to try to make this experience better. The first thing, which is a shout out more for tomorrow with Nico, is the Rust project goals. So this year we started this, and it's really awesome. You should watch Nico's talk. The other thing that we've started this year is participating in organizations that onboard new young contributors to open source. So if this is you this next year, be on the lookout for this. And don't worry, there is definitely plenty to do. And hopefully, through all of this, you can see that the Rust project is complex, but it's also exciting. Thank you all.